Hello, this is my first lecture on surface mechanics. So to go on with the surface mechanics, first you need to know that what is surface mechanics. So surface mechanics is basically a branch of physics and it relates the overall behavior of a system of many particles is related to the properties of the particle themselves. That means how the overall behavior of a system, how it is related to an individual particle, that is none other than the statistical mechanics. So what does it tell us? And in this phenomenon, statistical mechanics include huge number of particles, that we should be clear in the further notes. So basically, it also gives us the probability. It also will give us the probability distribution. Okay, that a particle has a certain amount of the energy at a certain moment. That which particle has a certain amount of energy, okay, and we at which moment. So it gives us the probability of that one. Now, coming on to the next slide. So first of all, I have said that it connects the macroscopic particle with microscopic one. So basically, if I say that what is a microscopic system, the word from the micro, we can say that it is small. So microscopic system are those which are very microbe-like structure. So which are microbe-like structure? They are the molecules, atoms and the ions. Okay, so move on to the macroscopic system. The word macro means huge, and these macroscopic system include a gaseous system, consider a bucket, and in that bucket you have some fruit. So you can say the fruit is the microscopic system, whereas the bucket full of fruit is the macroscopic system. So you can say here that the gaseous system consists of a large number of microscopic system. So in the thermodynamics, you have learned about that some of the particles is governed by the other. Some of the particles is governed by the other. Here also the energy of a gaseous system is expressed by such variables. And which variables? There are the four kinds of variable by which the energy of the gaseous system can be expressed. They are the temperature, they are the pressure, volume, and the number of the moles comprising it. Okay, so most that I have just tell now that it is characterized by the probability distribution of a possible state. Okay, it is basically characterized by a probability distribution. So how the probability distribution takes place is mainly carried out by this one. So going to the next slide. Now see some of the characteristics of the statistical mechanics. So to learn about the characteristics of the statistical mechanics, first one you need to know that it deals with a mechanical system. Second one, it is a probability, so it makes the prediction. And the prediction is correct for a huge number of variables. So here the variables nothing but the particles. So basically the statistical mechanics are correct for a system dealing with a large number of particles, and that particle may be about 10 to the power 23. So here a point to note that we cannot apply, okay, cannot, it is better to say impossible, okay, it is impossible to apply a principle of dynamics to a physical system containing a large number of particles. And such a problem can be solved by statistical method, and these methods are used to study the law governing the motion of large electron atom as well as the quantum molecules. Okay, so basically, so they are nearly correct for a huge number of particles. So in the probability, or in the case of prediction, if I take more amount of fluid, so we get perfect answer. So here also, if we need the last number, if we get the last number of particle, the statistical prediction will give us nearly the correct answer. So it will give us the correct for a system dealing with the large number of particle. Now going on to the next slide. So what is statistical distribution? So this statistical distribution is nothing but the most probable way in which a certain amount of energy E is distributed among n member of a system of particle at the thermal equilibrium at a temperature T. So basically it is the most probable way that a certain amount of energy, suppose there is certain amount of energy E and that is distributed among the n member. This is distributed among the n members. So if there is 20 members, it is distributed among the 20 members, and that is will be in the thermal equilibrium and at an absolute temperature T. So there will be absolute temperature T and in the thermal equilibrium also. So now if we consider the n E as the number of particles having the energy E, then we can say that there is a formula that we can go to, that n E equal to G E. If so, basically you want to say that what is basically a GE? The GE is basically nothing but the number of the state of energy, number of the state. So the energy, if there is 20 energies, there will be 20 state. Okay, so no, 20 into number of the state of number of state. So basically GE is a number of the state of energy E. So eta, so E, yeah, man, is corresponding to in E, how many state is there, that is known as the GE. And what is the FE? It is nothing but the frequency distribution. It is nothing but the frequency distribution. Okay, so what is the frequency distribution actually? Frequency distribution is nothing but the average number of the particle in each state of energy eta, and the probability, the occupancy of the each state of the energy eta. So it is nothing but the probability. This is actually a distribution function, and it is nothing but the average number of the particle. So what is the basically the how many in a system? So if I consider a system that has a energy eta, and so if I say that then part system has a particle of n, so this is the n, and this is the number of the state of that particle, and this is the average number of particle in the whole system. So this is the actually the statistical distribution. Okay, so going to the next slide. Now the statistical distribution are of three kind. First one is the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, second one is the Fermi-Dirac statistics, third one is the Bose-Einstein statistics. So what is the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics? It is the identical particle that is sufficiently far apart to be distinguishable. So they are the identical, they are both look like particle, that is the identical particle, and that are sufficiently far apart and it can be distinguishable. And their example is the molecules of the gas. So the when the gas, when the water is heated, a gas is coming out, and that molecule is that example, and it is negligible overlapping of psi. Now it is the indistinguishable identical part. Now the coming to the Bose-Einstein, it is the indistinguishable identical particle of zero or an integral spin. So it can be zero or any kind of the integral spin, and it do not obey the Pauli exclusion principle. So you know basically the Pauli exclusion principle, and if you do not know, go on to my lecture that I will give the link, and so see that the indiscriminate identical particle of zero or a integral spin boson. So what is basically a boson? Boson is nothing but a Bose-Einstein, and the example of the what is characteristic of boson, that it do not obey the Pauli exclusion principle, and it will be having a overlapping of sign. So basically, coming on to the Fermi Dirac statistics, so this Fermi Dirac statistics, so what is the basically a difference between the Bose-Einstein statistics and the Fermi Dirac statistics? So in the Bose-Einstein statistics, it is the indistinguishable identical particle of integral spin or zero, and in the Fermi Dirac statistics, this is the indistinguishable identical particle with odd half integral spin. So it is basically the odd, it will be the odd and it will be half also. So basically, if I mean to say that if n plus 1 by 2, okay, n plus 1, n plus sorry, it is basically 1 by 2, 3 by 2, and 5 by 2, okay, and this is the Bose-Einstein statistics. This is the Bose-Einstein statistics. So basically, it means that see in the upper part, this 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, and it will go up to this, and in the lower part all are 2 because this is a half. So in the upper part this is odd, and in the lower part this is the half. So it is odd half integral spin. So example is the fermion, and they do not obey the exclusion principle, but in the Bose-Einstein they do not obey the exclusion principle, and which is called as Fermi Dirac statistics. So coming on to the next slide, and we will go very detailed about this part in the many of the lectures. Now see Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics. So that time we have learned that the statistical distribution NE equals to GE into FE. So in this Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, such as the classical approach, so we know by the law that number of the, this is the identical and the distinguishable particle in a system of temperature T, and that is having an energy E. So basically we know the formula like NE equals to GE, that is the number of the set of the energy E equal to average number of particle, that is the FE. So we know the so here in the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, we have not the derivation in the first year. So basically just know that the frequency, that is the average number of particle, is nothing but AE minus E by KT. Okay, this is the average number of a particle. Okay, so if I know this, it is to be average number of particle, so putting this on this formula, we get this formula. Okay, we can get this formula. Okay, so now the equation A represents the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution law. So okay, so we know that it is the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution law, but this law cannot explain the behavior of photon. Okay, that is the black body radiation, or of the electron in the metal, that is a specific heat and the conductivity. Okay, now see so what do you mean by this slide, that in the black body radiation this equation cannot represent the black body radiation or of a specific heat capacity or of the conductivity. So this is the limitations or the drawback of the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics. So coming into the detailed part of the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, now see that we apply the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics to find out the distribution of the energy among the molecules of an ideal gas. So why we apply the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics is in order to find out that. So first you say that what we have learned in the statistical method. In the statistical method we have learned that the number of the the amount of energy E is distributed among the n member, okay, among the n member of the particle having the energy E, and that is the absolute temperature T. Okay, so here see that we can apply. So this is the to find out the distribution of energy. Okay, So we are finding out the distribution of energy, and that is among the molecule of ideal gas. Okay, that is among the n member of a particle. We have seen that. So here we are introduced to a new term that it can only be found in the case of the ideal gas. So basically, just consider a few points that we are taking a continuous distribution of molecular energy instead of taking the discrete set value. Okay, we are taking so this eta will be continuous and instead of decrease in this way. What do you mean by continuous? That is, if I consider such an example like that, it should be 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40. This is continuous. And what is discrete? This 10, 20, 30, 40, and this is a discrete one. So, coming to this formula, and if I consider any is a number of the molecules that lie between the energy, that is epsilon and epsilon plus d epsilon. So, we know this, that NEDE equal to GEFEDE. We can say, so if I take this DE term on G, okay, so we know Fe equals to AE minus epsilon by KT. We know this. So putting this, we can say that we can say or we can come to this equation, putting the value such as first is A, then is GE, then is this term, and then DE term. So we have finally derived to such a wonderful equation. Okay, now see the next slide. Now see, so number of the states just as the energy between epsilon and E plus D epsilon. So number of the states is nothing but the GE DE. So if we consider this to be a hollow, to be a sphere, and if I consider this portion of it, so this is going to have a momentum in a three dimension, that is pz, py, and px. Okay, and this is the radius p, and this is the thickness dp. Okay. So basically, if I consider the molecule of a gas, it should have a momentum. So we know the momentum formula equals to p equals to root over 2me. So basically, if I consider to be in the three dimension, we can also write this as root over of px square plus py square plus pz square. So, and we can also say that the number of state, that is GP DP with the momentum, is that is whose magnitude are in between the P and P plus DP, is equal to the volume of the spherical shell in the momentum, that is in the P in radius and DP in thick. Okay, and that is 4 pi r square. Okay. So now you can say the number of the state, that is dp dp, and that magnitude are in between the two momentum in coordinate, that is p and p plus dp, and which is very much proportional to the volume of the spherical shell, that is this spherical shell, and that has a volume. So what is the volume? It is nothing but the 4 pi p square. Okay, and that is with a if I take p as a radius and dp in thick, that is 4 pi p square dp. This is nothing but the volume. And if I consider the 4 pi to be constant and write this as b, so number of the momentum state gp dp is nothing but a bp square by dp, bp square into dp. So, and we can also write the momentum has correspond to a single energy E. So basically a particle have energy, and that energy corresponds to the momentum. So if I consider this, we can write P instead of E. So basically we are coming to this conclusion, and to interchange this P square and dP, we know that P equal to root over of 2mv and dP equal to md. If I differentiate it, it is coming as mde by root over of 2mv. 2ME. So basically the number of the state, number of the, that is energy state, that is nothing but if I put P in this equation and dP in this equation, it will be coming like this, and it is the number of the energy state. Okay, it will be coming like this. Okay, I am using a marker to make you well understand. It will be coming like this. So this is the equation, and now see that the number of the molecules, the number of the molecules that that lie within the energy, that between this and this, and is nothing but we can say the number of the energy that we can say that the energy will have, and that is the number of the energy, and we can substitute that equation with this. Which equation? If I go on to the previous slide, you can see the N equals to G into A E minus A E minus E by KT. In that equation, if we substitute this GEDE term, it will be coming as this. Okay, S is coming as this, and this is the equation for a one single particle or one single molecule. So basically if I need to consider it for a whole or total of the molecule, we have to nothing but the we have to integrate it. And if we integrate it from 0 to infinity, that is from the initial position to the very last position, and we are getting the final position of the particle. We are getting the final position or the final number of the particle, final number of particle or a molecule. Okay, so basically see, now we can see the graph here, that is between this KT, that is epsilon, and that is between the in epsilon, that is the number of particle and corresponding energy. So basically if I see this graph, it is first rising up and then it is slightly going down. So if I consider the Maxwell-Boltzmann equation, this graph will have a maximum value in this position, in this whole position will get a something maximum, because we are considering a probability of that term or a prediction of that term. So we have predicted that this have a value, maximum value within this term. We can't say that it will be maximum value at the top. We can't say from here. So it will have a maximum value from this term. Okay. So basically, you have to remember a formula, that is any, and this formula is very used in three case in finding out the three result. So basically, if I find out in the three result, you can say that. That we have come to derivation with a easily with a ease, basically if I remember this formula. So what is this formula? That is nothing but n e d e equal to 2 pi n by pi k t 3 by 2 e to the eta, that is epsilon e to the power half, that is the energy, and that is half, and e e minus e by k t d e. Okay, so this is a wonderful, very wonderful equation. Okay, that is NEDE, that is 2 pi n by pi k t 3 by 2, that is energy to the power half, that is power to the power half, and e to the power minus e by k t dE. Okay, now coming to our derivation, please remember this formula, please note it, because this is the formula in which we could continue with the three equations, and so wonderful equations here. Okay, now see. it is the average molecular energy. So what do you mean by average molecular energy? Average molecular energy is nothing but to calculate the total internal energy of a system. And if we calculate the total energy of a system, and the average is nothing but the divide the number of particles that is in. Okay, so basically, if I calculate the average energy, that is E, that is nothing but 0 to infinity, that is E. So to calculate the total energy, first we have to know that this is the formula for calculating the total energy. This is the formula for calculating the total energy. So if I put this equation, and this is we know ADD, just we have seen that 2 pi A pi kT whole to the power 3 by 2, E to the power half, energy to the power half, and that is E to the power, that is epsilon to the power E by kT, that is dE, that is 3 by 2 in kT. Okay, so basically we know this formula by the gamma beta function. We know this full formula by the gamma beta function. If I know this formula by the gamma beta function, let's apply it over here, and we are getting this. Okay, let's apply it over here, and we are getting this result. Okay, if I get the result, means that if we get the total energy here, if we get the total energy, so if we divide by n, that is 3 by 2 n kT, and from this equation it can be said that it is independent of the molecular mass. From this equation we can easily say that it is independent of the molecular mass, and we are integrating from the 0 to infinity E dE. Remember this, we calculate the total energy, any kind of total energy, whether it is total energy or it is speed, so we have to consider the any, and if you consider the momentum also, this will be p into np dp. So in the whole case, because as you are considering the energy, so you are considering e to any de. Okay, so this is the total, basically you can say it is the average energy, and to calculate the energy we have to integrate it any de, and we will get in the result. And this is the independent molecular energy, and we can get many sums from here. Please remember the formula. See, here is the equipartition of the energy. So average kinetic energy is associated with each degree of freedom is nothing but half kT. Okay, so the molecule has a 3 degree of freedom, and that corresponds to the 3 momentum direction, and that is in the independent direction, and the average kinetic energy of a molecule is nothing but a 3 by 2 kT, and so we can associate the half kT with the average energy of each degree of freedom. So we can say that half mx square equals to half my square equals to half mz square, mb square, nothing but the kinetic energy formula. This is the x axis, this is the y axis, and this is the z axis. And we are associating the half kT with each degree of freedom, and that is nothing but the equipartition theorem. Okay, now distribution of the molecular speed. So we have just come to the formula that ADE, what will be the ADE. So if I substitute the E by half mv square, that is the kinetic energy, and if I differentiate the ADE equals mv dv, and if I substitute the E in place of half mv square, and if I substitute the ADE in the place of if I substitute the VE in place of DE, we are getting this equation. And how to find out RMS velocity? RMS velocity is nothing but N into NV dV by N. Okay, if I calculate this N, please remember N into NV dV, okay, by N. Okay, so by this equation we can find out the RMS velocity. Okay, now coming to the next slide. So just now we have found out the NV dV, so substituting the E in place of V. So if we substitute the E, and for on that term if we place the V, we are getting this equation, and if I differentiate it NV dV, we are getting this equation. And remember one term, that for a most probable speed this must be equal to 0. For a most probable speed, this must be equal to 0. And if this equal to 0, we are getting this equation, and from that we are getting the most probable speed. We are getting the most probable speed from this equation. Okay, now average speed. What is the average speed? The number of the molecule whose speed is between the P plus dV in a sample of n molecule. And to find out the average speed dV, we multiply the n with dV and integrate over it 0 to infinity and divide by n. So V equal to 1 by n V n V dV. So if I take V, so we have said that the average speed, average molecular energy. So also to calculate the average speed, this is 1 by n V into n V dV. Okay, so we have done in the average energy that 1 by n eta into n E dE. So in the average speed, we have doing this. So if I substitute the value, will get this equation. Okay, if I am and just use that formula that I have shown just before, and we are getting this value, and that is nothing but the average speed. Okay, the average speed of a molecule that is lying between V plus dV. Okay, now going to the next slide, we just now have seen one graph, and that I have told that the highest energy will be in certain region like this, and we have to find out the probability that where the certain order of prediction that where the highest molecular energy will be here or here or here, because we can know the exact location of where the highest molecular energy is there. So basically so it can be said that the peak distribution is not symmetrical. First reason is that why it is difficult to find out, and next the conclusion we can draw from the three derivation that always the RMS is greater than V dash, greater than VMP. Okay, this is the most molecular energy, this is the average, and this is the RMS. So what is the average? Average will be this, and RMS will be this one, we have known, and the molecular speed is this one. So it is the EMP, this is the molecular speed, this is the RMS. Okay, this is the RMS, and this is the VDR, that is the average. Okay, this is the average. So here we are coming to the conclusion. Next, the last slide. This is the variation in the molecular speed with the T and the molecular mass. So if we see the graph, let's see the oxygen, the two oxygens, that is ME 373 Kelvin. This oxygen is 273 Kelvin, this hydrogen is 273 Kelvin. So first compare, so forget about this. Okay, so first compare oxygen and hydrogen. First compare. So basically, if I compare the oxygen and hydrogen with the respect to the molecular mass, with the respect to the molecular mass, we can easily see that the most probable speed is greater for a lighter mass, and the lighter mass is the hydrogen. So if the MPH is greater, that is the molecular speed we are denoted by MPH, it should be shifted from the left to right. Okay, it should be shifted from the left to right. That's why it is just shifted from the left to the right. Okay, note this point. And if I consider these two oxygen, one is at the temperature 273 Kelvin and one is at the temperature 273 Kelvin. So most movable speed is directly proportional to the temperature, and its most probable speed is inversely proportional to 1 by T. So here in this case, in the molecular speed is proportional to the temperature, but those having a higher energy, higher temperature will have a greater molecular speed. So basically, if the temperature is greater, MPH, that is most molecular speed, is increased, and the peak that is here, that is shifted towards the, from the left to right. This peak will be shifted, see this peak has something shifted towards the left to right. Okay, because of the temperature, because of the increase of the temperature. But the area and number of the molecule or the area under the peak remain unchanged. Okay, the number of the molecule inside the peak or the area under the peak remain unchanged. So this is a huge application for these graphs, that is the temperature and that is the molecular speed. Whereas the most probable speed is directly proportional to the temperature, whereas the most probable speed is inversely proportional to the molecular mass that we have seen in the oxygen hydrogen. And but the one thing to note, please note it in your copy here, the peak is shifted, peak can be shifted from the left to right, okay, because of the temperature or due to the molecular mass, but the area under the curve remain unchanged. So, or we can say that the molecule inside the curve can remain unchanged. This is a huge application of the today's lecture. So, I am ending this lecture. Let's meet on my new lecture. Goodbye.